Good afternoon to all of you. Today we are meeting here to confer honoris causa on Srimati Aruna Roy, political and social activist, who was instrumental in shaping up the Right to Information Act. And the 15th convocation of the University of Hyderabad, held on October 1, 2013, had conferred the degree of Doctorate of Literature honoris causa upon Srimati Aruna Roy. The university is privileged to make use of this opportunity to honor the recipient by presenting the degree that had been conferred upon her earlier. Now I request the Chancellor, Vice Chancellor, Registrar, Dean of School of Social Sciences, and the recipient of the degree, Srimati Aruna Roy, to come on to dais. Now I request Professor Ramakrishna Ramaswamy, the Vice Chancellor, University of Hyderabad, to read out the citation and present the degree.
Srimati Aruna Roy ji, you are a leading voice in the people's struggle for the right to information, employment, and food security in our country. Coming from a family with progressive ideals, you learnt organizing social activities under the guidance of your father, a lawyer and a civil servant. You joined the civil service as an IAS officer in 1968, but resigned in 1974, seeing the status quo policies of the Indian bureaucratic system as a hurdle in the process of delivering social and economic justice to the poor of India. You founded the Mazdoor Kisan Shakti Sangathana and the national campaign for people's right to information that culminated in the 2005 RTI Act. These are among your most important contributions and have empowered the common man like never before. You have been instrumental in the formulation of several rural development policies, including the MGNREGA. Your fight against corruption at the uppermost levels has resulted in the formulation of an alternative Lokpal bill. Indeed, you have contributed enormously to the establishment of Lokpal by taking the issue into the public domain. Your efforts have been recognized through the Ramon Magsaysay Award in the year 2000 for community leadership, and in 2010, the prestigious Lal Bahadur Shastri National Award for Excellence in Public Administration, Academia, and Management. You have immensely influenced academia, particularly in the fields of political science, public administration, and human rights, and have been a great source of inspiration to young scholars. We are proud to join a large number of organizations and institutions that have recognized your notable contributions and are honored that you will accept the degree of Doctor of Literature honoris causa of the University of Hyderabad that is being conferred upon you.
Now I request Srimati Aruna Roy to give her acceptance speech.
The Vice Chancellor, faculty, students, I am deeply honored that you should recognize me this way. I am a Jholawali, popularly known as a Jholawali everywhere in the papers, and the place I know best is the street. So for me to get an honor this time from the hallowed walls of academia means a lot. But as my friend Shankar says, for people with whom I work, he says, and I speak in Hindi, he says, tum yahan aaoge aur apne aap ko doctor saab kehlaoge to to pura jagah bhar jayega marizon ke saath. Wo to kahenge hamare to kya bimari tum sahi karogi. So I come from a different world, but where your recognition and this honor you conferred on me and through me to all of us will push our struggles and our battles for a more equal, a more just, a less poor, and a better world further. Thank you very much.
I want to acknowledge the Chancellor, who, as member of the National Advisory Council with me, pushed the National Rural Employment Guarantee Act when even within the Advisory Council there are disputes and differences. The country owes the NREG also to the Chancellor, who pushed it there. I have Mr. Venugopal sitting in the audience, who, when we were not well known and being beaten up by sarpanches and punches and ward punches for the right to information, came and stood with us, completely incognito, looking like an ordinary person when he was still just out of the government, helping us propagate the idea of accountability in circles where our voices did not matter. I have many young friends here who are now with the government of Andhra Pradesh, who are working independently, who have all contributed to the concept of the right to information. And in the audience, there are many users of the RTI, campaigners of the RTI and others. This whole degree actually is yours. Because in a sense, that it's a recognition of a large collective effort, and unfortunately it goes to single people. So I have received it on your behalf. I want to thank all of you very much today. I have opted to talk about democratic governance because it is really a contemporary discourse. But actually, the subtext of my heading, which says the challenge to the Indian Constitution in a neoliberal world, gives you the context of my concerns. Because I do come, and my constituency is the poor. My constituency is rural India. And I can't show you where I live today because there is some mismanagement on my part. But I wanted to show you the small hut in which the Mazdoor Kisan Shakti Sangathana began its life and continues to stay. Because we feel that the other side of India is still invisible, no matter what we do. And it's very important to bring their concerns out into the public domain. And by and large, and all of us owe the poor peasants and workers of central Rajasthan a great debt, because it was their persistence and their understanding that made us all understand the importance of transparency and accountability in governance. And they stayed on the road for more than 14 years fighting for it, leaving their homes, coming and staying for days and days on roadsides in dharnas and protests asking for information. Anyway, but today, in today's contemporary world, in the days of tumult and new happenings and hope, I do think that the question of governance is extremely important. Till 20 years ago, most of us in the world of social activism dismissed governance as a non-issue. And I remember in the early days of the RTI that the MKSS was often critiqued because we engaged with issues of governance. And there were two aspects to this critique. The first was that we were asking for transparency and accountability, which was an esoteric concern of seminar rooms and bureaucrats. And the other critique was that radical change will only come after a complete change in the regime. The government was seen as an enemy to be battled with, and the claim that it should perform for us was dismissed as a syndrome of dependence, which undermined self-reliance. And this was a Gandhian critique as well. People who were Gandhian critiqued us. If a government was formed by a party that was ideologically inimical, questions were raised almost with any form of engagement with that government. Behind both these critiques were the two binaries that continued to dominate thought and language, even though political engagement has changed. Breaking these down, these twin binaries, A, of poverty and governance, and B, of radical revolutionary change all in one shot, or continual struggle and incremental change through engagement, have been an important part of our evolving journey. We argued that in a democracy, we need to own the government as the simple largest institution paid for and maintained by taxpayers' money. It must work for us within the constitutional framework. The widespread acceptance of this discourse is because of the RTI. Its use in campaigns helped ordinary people lay claim over the centers of power and decision-making in government. We also realized and argued that transparency and accountability were transformatory rights linked to issues of poverty and injustice, and democratizing governance had to become part of the struggle for economic and social equality. Political change is a result of deliberate efforts for economic and, political change is a result of deliberate efforts, and a critical analysis is crucial to the fostering of the process of change. As we stand at another turning point in our electoral politics, and I don't need to explain why, we need to understand where many of these processes originated and how they developed. While we use the energy that is generated to carry these processes forward, we also need to make sure that we do not get lost in the temporary euphoria of the manifestation of change. The need to protect the non-party political space is therefore crucial at a time when many of the votaries of that space are seeking to enter electoral politics. Only then will the binary of inside and outside be overcome in a way that allows democracy to function in a participatory manner. Similarly, the binary of poverty and governance will have to be broken down to ensure that economic and social and political equality are fostered in a synergetic and politically astute and rational manner. Slogans often encapsulate political perceptions. One that was coined years ago by the Mazdoor Kisan Shakti Sangathana: ye sarkar hamare aapki nahi kisi ke baap ki, paise hamare aapka nahi kisi ke baap ka, ye desh hamare aapka nahi kisi ke baap ka. Created and spread the discourse. All of government, its structure and functioning and its money, everything was claimed as people's property, to be transparent and accountable. The new currency was information, and it even replaced the bribe in a new and powerful form of demand and supply, where integrity remained intact and rights were protected. Ordinary central Rajasthani villagers made the quantum leap from indifference to engagement and from passivity to action. It was something worth the seeing. The RTI as a fundamental right has distributed power. It has also empowered other campaigns with valid data to form public opinion. It is a transformatory act which enables the use of all constitutional rights. The feudal role of patronage could eventually be discarded. The bureaucratic stranglehold from which I released myself was and is too familiar. I really call it a stranglehold because you don't even know that the bureaucracy operates to stop or promote any scheme or any law or any process. I grew up in Delhi, which is a bureaucratic city. Delhi is full of graded civil servants. Colonies are graded, snobbery of addresses and privileges. It's impossible not to be aware of the structure called government, however tangentially. Fathers came home and spoke of cases and tales. The irregularities in government were the substance of many evening conversations and heated arguments. Unconsciously, we became aware that two structures ran and controlled our public life. There were politicians and there were babus. It was an irony that of the two structures in governance, the civil service was extolled, while politics was not on the radar of careers or social commitment. No one talked about it. Every critic of the system wanted his or her daughter in the IAS. Politics was reserved for failures and those who could do no better. We grew up without understanding the power and the possibilities of the political system. One was conditioned to believe that the civil servants ruled the country, recall the popular Yes Minister series of the BBC, which we have all seen. The civil service was expected to transform the constitutional guarantees into systemic processes, narrow the gap between promise and action. Bureaucratic intervention was supposed to influence and reduce the power of caste and other social inequities, but it unfortunately became a tool of those very issues which it sought to set aside. Discriminatory practices were part of the system. In fact, I remember how, with what contempt we referred to, I don't include myself, but it was I was part of the system then, that people who came from poorer backgrounds were contemptuously discussed. Rules were bent to deliver, but only for a group of people, and you had to be in that select group to get anything at all from the government. The rule of law was made subservient to opportunism and personal gain. The civil service lent its weight with specious arguments and technicalities to siphon money and deny rights, allowing the political system to misappropriate and mismanage. If you ask me, as I've often been asked, how would you divide the corruption between the bureaucrats and the politicians? I use a simple adage that poor workers use to describe how much money is sent to the village for materials and labor. We use a ratio which is called 60-40. So I say it's a 60-40 ratio. 60% is bureaucracy and 40% is politicians. Because for every act of corruption, for every single political act of corruption, you need more civil servants who perform the act than politicians. I quote Dr. Ambedkar, who said that we don't have a recognition of the concept of fraternity. Fraternity means a common brotherhood of all Indians. But in our faith in democracy, we must resolve that whatever we do not help the enemies of democracy to uproot the principles of liberty, equality, and fraternity. It goes to show that we have not upheld these values, because India today is a very divided society in which fraternity is hardly on the radar of most of us. And he says, Ambedkar goes on to say, that if democracy dies, it'll be our doom. And for a moment, if any of us stops to think what would happen if the democratic system collapsed and wondered why we don't foster it to become better, I would say we should. Because if there is no democracy, there is no right to information. If there is no democracy, there is no right to dissent. There's no democracy, there's no right to express a different opinion. And India is a pluralistic, vocal, volatile society and a volatile people. So though issues which break the principles of the Constitution must be stemmed, we must have freedom of expression, and we should have all the other rights enshrined in the Constitution. Just for a moment, if we look at what's happening in the Northeast or what's happening in Kashmir, we know how valuable it is that we have access to constitutional rights and to express them in a manner in which we can also fight corruption. A system of governance, mythically or at least in a utopian frame, should be a bulwark of the democratic system. But it has become, for the poor, especially, the perpetrator of inequality and arbitrariness. The common manifestation of this is corruption. An arbitrary use of power, its flip side. We think of corruption, but we seldom think of the arbitrary use of power, which is sometimes much more harmful than sheer corruption. And I've heard people say that X is a very honest person, that X can be a communalist, can be believe in cup panchayats, X can believe in gender differentiation and violence, but because you don't take a bribe, you're extolled. So we have to also include in every definition of corruption the fact that that person must not use power arbitrarily. When I resigned and came back from the IAS in 75, I really left a dedicated space for governance. So very often I was asked, why have you left that space to come back and fight this battle outside? But I left and came out because constitutional obligations served no purpose when I was in the IAS, and no question of rights ever discussed. All that we discussed in our little clubs within the civil service at that time, and I, of course, restrict myself to the Delhi administration where I worked, and I know that the state boasts of excellent people who are in the IAS and gave some of the best to the world and this country. So I'm not talking of all civil servants, but my experience led me to believe that promises, constitutional promises, do not exist in the life of the daily life of a civil servant. I knew also that the system of governance must be a dialectic between the civil service and its people, between government and the citizen. But the inherent inequality in the relationships which dominated every kind of discrimination continued to rule. We have a feudal social structure and a political democracy. Even today, And if we don't acknowledge it, we can't address it. The most important thing to address any problem is to first recognize it. And I think we must recognize it. No point getting into euphoric states and believing that the world will change. We still live in a very, very feudal society. The MKSS was born out of a people's understanding that the democratic system demands engagement with governance. And we were not ashamed to say it. And many of the battles we had with other organizations was that we went into dialogue with government. How could we do it? So any attempt to transform rights means that you have to transform it into access to services and a transparent and accountable system for the poor. Transparency and accountability also helps prepare grounds for participatory governance. How? You don't know what the panchayat gets. You don't know what roads are built. You don't know what money comes and goes. How are you going to participate in any decision making? Just to tell you a tale, just a small story. When we did the first public hearing in 1994, 2nd of December, in a small village called Kot Kirana, the district of Pali, we accessed records without the law. We just went and copied all the muster rolls and bills and vouchers. And Shankar, my friend, who sat there in the BDO office, horrified gaze of all the staff, copied it by hand because the SDM had just come down from the Indian, the IAS school in Mussoorie, where he had been lectured by Harsh Mandar that transparency is very important. So he thought he should allow us to sit and copy those papers. The papers were copied, Shankar came out, and he walked into the village, and there was all hell broke loose. Because on the muster roll were dead people's names. On the muster roll were the names of women like me who don't know how to wield any of the tools of agriculture and labor, and false bills, incomplete buildings declared complete. So when we had that public hearing, the whole village, after having been bullied and 2.5 lakhs spent by the powers that be to prevent them from coming to this public hearing to depose, came in spite of that. And in that public hearing, history was made, and thereafter, right to information was established. But they would have never come. Those 1,500 people who came despite all the threats would never have come if they didn't know what the public hearing was actually going to disclose. And it's that information and that power of that information that forced the participation of people not in a physical sense, but in a very sound scientific sense, that they felt that they had to come, they had to hear, they had to understand what was happening in that village. Therefore, people's movements, which is the other strain from which the MKSS comes, is a political movement which exists outside electoral politics, but looks at itself as a tool which will give the people a structure and a process to engage with politics, with electoral politics, through the prism of ethics and principles. Very often, even today, I'm asked, why aren't you doing something political? Because even our minds, even today, politics is only that political party and that vote. But in this country, we have inherited one of the strongest processes in the world. When we got all these laws, and when I went to Brazil and to Mexico or to Europe, they were all astonished that a people's voice about policy could find space in government and force them to enact legislations. I was repeatedly asked, how is this parallel system there in India? So even today, the space outside party politics, the space for conscience politics, the space for public statement of the unpleasant and unpopular ideas is important if we want India to be a balanced political structure where we want democracy to work, not only for the people who can run the system, but for people who will always remain to receive from the system what it can deliver. When I went first to Rajasthan, 1974, 75, many years before all you young people were born, probably your mothers were born then, at that time, when I went to Rajasthan, and I was full of energy, and I thought, here I am, going to speak to them and get engaged with them. And I went to the village, and I said to these women, because the men wouldn't talk to me, because they wouldn't make eye contact with me, because I was a woman. How could they talk to me? I'm a woman. So they would not talk to me. If I took a little young child with me, they'd speak to the young child, but not to me. Now Rajasthan has changed, but it was like that then. So there was no conversation possible with the men. So in my conversations with the women, I said to them, look, the school doesn't run, you're not worried. The panchayat doesn't run, you're not worried. And they said to me in their local language, they said, balba dijo, which means let it burn. They said, it's not our money. Why are we bothered with it? With the Right to Information campaign, after many years, 20 years, when Sushila came to Delhi in 1996, when the National Campaign for People's Right to Information was born, we'd come and Justice Savant was heading a committee and he was talking about the law, and Sushila was part of that because she'd fought many street battles, passed class 4, and she was asked by the press, what are you doing here? You don't understand anything. What is this right to information? What are you doing here? And she said in Hindi, she said, मैं अपने बेटे को बाजार भेजती हूँ 10 रुपए के साथ और वो वापस आता है तो मैं उससे हिसाब लेती हूँ ये देश मेरे नाम से अरबों खरबों रुपए खर्च करती है हिसाब नहीं लूँगी क्या ये हमारा पैसा हमारा हिसाब सो इन फोर वर्ड्स सुशीला डिफाइंड द होल कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ द आरटीआई एंड यू कैन सी द ट्रेजेक्टरी ऑफ दैट जर्नी फ्रॉम बल्बा दो टू ये पैसा हमारा है ये हिसाब हमारा है It is the kind of political education that is necessary to keep electoral politics in place and to make it deliver. But it's necessary, therefore, that not only the poor, but everybody understands governance. Governance becomes the tool through which all our rights, all our lives are determined. Finally, the middle class has understood it and it's trying to do something about it. But the vote notwithstanding, feudal and traditional social formations remain the same. You just look at it. If you demand a right, even today, under the NREGA, and you go to a village in Barmer or you go to Jharkhand, you are killed. Jodhpur, recently, 2 months ago, an NREGA worker was killed. 2 people have been killed in Jharkhand for doing nothing more than asking for accounts under the RTI of the NREGA. So the panchayat system is also absorbed into the feudal system. And the privileged even today, despite everything, even though we have reserved seats for the Dalits, we have reserved seats for the women in Rajasthan, only those Dalits and those women that the powerful elite want can contest elections in many cases. I remember Pyarji, Sarpanch of Bori, who was brought from Surat, and he belonged to a scheduled caste community that was a minority. So they brought him from Bori. These rich people went all the way to Surat and brought him, made him stand and made him defeat a large community of Dalits who lived there and their representative, because one man could be controlled. But they didn't bargain with Pyarji's honesty. Pyarji came to us and said, I've been given a stamp pad and a rubber stamp. And he said, मेरा काम और कुछ नहीं है कहते ठपा टप लगाओ ठपा टप लगाओ ठपा टप लगाओ ही केम एंड सेड मेरी जनसुनवाई करो हैव अ सोशल ऑडिट ऑन मी एंड वी सेड टू हिम प्यार जी यू दे विल हैव यू फॉर सपर बिकॉज यू हैव साइंड एंड ऑल काइंड्स ऑफ डॉक्यूमेंट्स ही सेड मैं क्या कर सकता हूँ मुझे कुछ पता ही नहीं है ठपा टप ठपा टप ठपा टप एंड सम फ्रेंड्स सिट हियर वेंट एंड डिड द सोशल ऑडिट ऑन दैट बोरी पंचायत बट फाइनली ही गॉट एग्जोनरेटेड बिकॉज वी फॉट फॉर हिम with the government saying you cannot have an innocent person who can't read or write and has no social or political backing, be at the mercy of the ex-ruling elite in that village to do wrong things. So anyway, for us, the issues have only subtly changed. And Ambedkar is still only a name. I have been repeatedly to so many Republic Day functions in my village panchayat. I go every time. And I vote from a village. I am a Gram Sabha member. So I go and vote from that village. And every 26th of January, when I say to them, how many of you have read the constitution? It's a school building. There were 2,000 people, their teachers, their principals. About 6 hands go up. And when you say, how many of you have seen the Constitution? Maybe 10 hands go up. And then you ask them, do you really remember anything about the Constitution? Nothing. So Ambedkar Jayanti, we go in Rajasthan, thousands of people come, they adore and idolize Ambedkar, but have not read the Constitution. Unfortunately, for a political democracy like ours, no matter, my young friends here, no matter what discipline you are in, you have to have an acquaintance with the preamble to the Constitution, the chapter on fundamental rights, and the chapter on directive principles of state policy. You also must read other parts of the Constitution. We are asked to critique the Constitution, and we begin by saying, yes, the Constitution must be changed. It's a terrible Constitution, without knowing what it contains. So it's a terrible thing that we, intelligent people, within inverted commas, literate people, so-called educated people, do not acquaint ourselves with a basic document that is the basis of governance and rules all of us. Despite whatever we say, despite all the modernization, all the wearing of jeans and everything of men and women, when I say jeans, I'm not only talking of women, also talking of men, and all the changes that have come to be in rural India, despite the television and the mobile phone, honor killings happen. How can honor killings happen in a society which knows something of the Constitution? How can honor killings happen in a society in which equality is accepted? These shocking instances happen sometimes just near Delhi. The Kap Panchayats are not in remote Assam. They are next door to Delhi in Haryana. An ineffective system doesn't use the powers it has under the Constitution to stop it. They plead that social tradition is very powerful and that the rule of law can be set aside. It took so long for anyone to be arrested for burning and killing people who married intercommunity. So the bureaucrat and the politician stand above the law, and that's why this reaction we have today. In the middle of the sharply divided and discriminating social structure, corruption is a manifestation which provokes public anger and angst. What do you see when you go? You see it as corruption. Somebody asks you for money. Somebody asks you for, what do they call it, when you quickly have to pass a file, you pay 5 rupees. So that's okay. You pay 10 rupees in a railway compartment to get a berth. It's okay. You pay 2 rupees to the cop, or 10 rupees, no 2 rupees anymore. 10 rupees, 100 rupees, 200 rupees, 1,000 rupees, depending on what you've done wrong. To the cop, it's all right. If we do not see this corruption as not just money, but a misuse of governance, a lack of transparency, immunity, impunity, if we do not see it in these terms, we will not fight the larger battles which will guarantee you and me that we'll live in a more peaceful society where we will not see cops with guns. For me, that has been a symbol of an India that frightens me. I grew up in an India where no cop had a gun. I walked miles in Delhi at night and there was no one with a gun. Today, every corner has a picket and you have cops with guns. And I think it's quite frightening. So in a sense, if we want a peaceful society, and post Nirbhaya, if we want a society which will look kindly at women, we need to look at the more important issues. So it was with the looking at the arbitrary use of power and information that the MKSS began its struggle, and out of this was born the RTI. We are all sure that it's people's perception and people's understanding that will be the final verdict on assessing corruption and remedying it. The Vigilance Department is corrupt. You have to bribe the Vigilance Department for the Vigilance Department to take up a case. If you go to the Anti-Corruption Department, you have to bribe the Anti-Corruption Department. So ultimately, it's only the people who can monitor corruption. So the vote, not as a symbol, but as a continuing kind of guarantee of the transfer of my sovereignty to my representative must function. So I must be able to use what I've transferred from my sovereignty to that legislator or the member of parliament to work. In the right to information law, there is a section which says that notwithstanding anything said in this act, all information that is available to an elected representative, that is an MLA or an MP, is available to the people of India. Whatever my representative can see, I can see, because my sovereignty is transferred to that person. So the only way we can get that social and economic power that Ambedkar was so worried about into reality is if we question that vote and make that vote work systematically for the poor. And that's what the poor have now started doing, and they face repression again. But doesn't matter. That's a historical process, and we should be able to get over it. Charul and Vinay, who have been composing songs, they are from a group in Gujarat which works with people's policy. And Vinay is an ex-IIM graduate, and Charul is an architect. But they've teamed up, and they also sing songs. I don't know how many of you know Mandir Masjid Girja Ghar Ne Baant Leya Bhagwan Ko, Dharti Baanti Sagar Baanta Mat Baanto Insaan Ko. A song I think many of us sing. But they also made a right to information song in which the lyric connects access to people's needs with information. And one couplet says in it, Mere vote ko janne ka hak hai, ek din bade bade vaade, aur 5 saal kaam nahi. To wo roz roz ke vaade. So that is why the emphasis on participation and right to information becomes so important to all of us, because it is those little things that really stop us from getting access to what we should. But what about this power? Everybody says, power. What is power? As a feminist, for me, when people say, you've left the IAS, you left power to go and become a poor person in a village, I feel there's something wrong in that perception of power. What is power? So a friend of mine recently, when I went to a wedding, an ex-batchmate of mine, and amongst all of us, we met there, and somebody said, poor Aruna, you know, she's been living very badly all these years, and look at her. Another chap said, no, you got it all wrong. He said she's given up economic comforts for mental comfort, and we're all trapped. We have economic comfort, but we're trapped in mental discomfort. I don't know which is better. So in a sense, that was one definition. The other was power. How do you recognize power? Is power that Lal Batti, which has now become such an issue of discussion, which Shankar, when he went to the IAS Academy, said, oh, I see series of Lal Battis here, because he saw so many IAS officers. He says, when one Lal Batti comes to my village, we are all stunned by the fact that it's come to us. But here there are 500 Lal Battis. So Lal Batti culture or not, the point is that we have to understand that power doesn't lie in these symbols. Power really lies elsewhere. And that's why democracy is so important. Because in using the rights that we've been given under democratic systems and the constitution, we can really go a long way. But there are some challenges and there are some problems. I know that we talk about the majority with great confidence and assurance in this country. And whenever large numbers of people come, the administration just comes down under the weight of it. It can be any agitation, it depends on how many numbers you are. But there is something which is not based on numbers, and those are principles. So if democracy does not look at that, and look at where the principles lie, and even if a large majority should say it, have the gumption to say that you are wrong. We call it majoritarianism now, but I don't know what. It's a word that is not there in any dictionary, but we call it that. And we must remember that even when we extol all the people who fought for our independence, Gandhiji, when he went on the Dandi March, Rabindranath Tagore wrote a song for him called Akla Chalore. He didn't say so many people are going. He said Akla Chalore. He said one person goes, with a principle, it's worth it. And we must not forget Chauri Chaura when Gandhi stopped the agitation because it violated his principles. Do we have the guts to look at things that go wrong, which render injustice and violence, which promote discrimination, and which promote all the negatives, even if there is a majority, will be a challenge to any democratic government. And I say this today, because increasingly, in your social media, how many likes? You can like anything. I can like Colgate toothpaste. I can like, what? Shah Rukh Khan. I can like Amir Khan. I can like anything. Does that determine the value of a thing? So what are likes? And recently, Cobra Post in Delhi exposed the fact that your social media can be bought in just the same way as paid news can be bought. I suppose you all know that you can buy news, especially during election, you can buy likes and dislikes, and there is a fee for it. Like that, social media can also be bought. Your likes can be bought, and they camouflage the source of those yeses and likes in such a manner that nobody can find out where they come from. We have a tendency to lionize these things and idealize these things. First, akhbar kehta hai, they would say. Akhbar kehta hai, sach hoga. Now kehte hai, social media mein itne likes hai, toh wo achha hoga. We have to use our sense of discrimination and understanding to see where principles are not violated, where there's no history. And history is important in politics. You must go beyond just your memory. You have to go back at least 30 years or 40 years in Indian history to see who has done what has happened and what is the consequence, what is the result of it before you take a decision. Otherwise, we will be making gross mistakes. For me, it's a nightmare that haunts me. What happens when the majority decides that something wrong is right? So the Constitution, whether we read it or not, it should be the guiding factor in such issues. And there are principles. And I think it's time that we talked about those principles. One of those things is the word secular. When I go and say, what is secular? I never get the right response. They talk about atheism. Somebody talks about everyone's equal. But no one says to me that secularism defines the state. I'm not talking about you people. I'm talking about young people who study, who go, are getting neoliterate. What is secularism? It defines the state. It doesn't define you or me. It defines the state. And yet we go about talking how India has been ruined because there is this word in the Constitution. But Ambedkar also made that famous speech in which he talked about contradictions. We will have one man, one vote. I just object to that. We'll say one person, one vote. And we must remove this contradiction at the earliest possible moment. Otherwise, those who suffer from inequality will blow up the structure of democracy, which this Constituent Assembly has so laboriously built up. Let us just look at some of the things that have been happening in our polity in the recent years. Just let's see where the system has repeatedly, constantly, and deliberately neglected economic and social equality. What has it resulted in? It's resulted in the emergence of formations of people to demand fulfillment of promises, and sometimes with extremism. We damn the extremism, but we don't understand that this violence of these formations can be traced to 60 odd years of neglect of governance to deliver the most minimal basics. In theory, the Constitution provided for tribal autonomy, but there's no such thing. On the one hand, we say panchayats will decide, the tribals will decide, they have autonomy. They want to protect their forests. An MNC goes in, the MNC goes in, it wants the forests. Government doesn't do much in the beginning. There's protest is damned, then there's ensuing violence, that violence is damned, and then starts a spiraling of violence from the people, violence from the state, violence from the people, violence from the state. And ultimately, it results in a situation where there is no development, there is no services, there is no equality, and there is no social mobility. And I think unless we realize this and we work for this, And I think we have really let too much time pass, but even now it's not too late. Actually, the neoliberal framework of economic globalization has brought in a lot of violence in many parts of India. We have not accepted it enough. We have not accepted that it basically and radically alters power relationships. If we look at, there's a short clip I have of people from POSCO fighting against POSCO in Odisha. They've been on a dharna for years. And in that interview, one ordinary guy says, in Odia, he says, is this democracy? I was told that I could decide for myself. I've decided I don't want this plant. But the collector and the chief minister say that their decision is bigger than mine. This is democracy. So in a sense, let us see, if we want constitutional provisions, we want what we want, then we must absolutely be mindful of what we give to the others. Grassroots movements have sprung up, and I will say this, that the movements in the last so many years, it's been so many references have been made in the earlier in the evening, all these laws that we are talking about now, all these rights-based laws, have come from people's movements and their effort to make this policy. They have drawn strength and inspiration from the Constitution and the directive principles of state policy. Today, the inability for the government to deny us these rights, whether it's the right to food or the right to work, because it emanates from the Constitution. So in a sense, politically, how are you going to deny these rights without denying the Constitution? In a sense, inequality today and poverty is not merely because of corruption, but it's also because of the kind of policies we are choosing to implement. The irony is that these areas, truth is an embarrassment, and rights is a terrorist position. The poor who have been caught in this net face the worst a people can end in their own free nation. No right to question the state, and any question is damned. So, in a sense, what are we pushing India into is a question mark. So whether we are here or whether we are in the Northeast, whether we are in the South or whether they are in the West, there must be some uniformity in the way in which an ordinary citizen interfaces with the state. I remember in Delhi, once there was a meeting, and it was not an issue on the Armed Forces Special Powers Act, but Manipuri students and other students were part of the general debate on democracy, and they stood up and they said, we have a question from the state, but we also have a question from all of you. Are we not citizens of this country? Are we not people? Don't we have the same rights as you have to report against corruption, to report against rape, to report against injustice? Because the moment we do it, we become insurgents. Don't we have the same rights? So I think somewhere governance will also have to address these issues. The nascent effort of the Aam Aadmi Party to bring civil society modes and issues into structures into the mainstream has brought a fresh wave of hope to all of us. But probably it's still too early to evaluate it. It has moved from a people's movement to a political party. There have been sporadic efforts in the past to make this change, but nobody took the plunge, and these people have. However, questions still need to be addressed. How can we assess the success of Aam Aadmi Party? Will it have the same success in rural areas where there are vote banks? Will it have the same success in areas in which you have to take a position? You cannot get votes unless you take a position. You can't say, I'm thinking about it, I'll give you a reply tomorrow. Where corruption cannot be the only issue on which you stand, or giving water or electricity cannot be the only issue on which you stand. Will they be able to cross that barrier when they come to it? Will they be able to form a cohesive, if simplistic, ideology which people can understand and vote for? Many years ago, the National Alliance for People's Movements had tried something called Lok Rajniti Manch in the early 2000s. But the issues that stalled Lok Rajniti Manch was because the ideological positions of the Manch did not allow taking some posturing that was necessary to push a political agenda. It's very difficult sometimes because you must, just as Prashant says sometimes suddenly, that Kashmir must have the right to a plebiscite, or that POSCO, or that Kudankulam, people have a right. Now, will that or will that not upset a balance is a question they are facing. Anywhere you go, there are these questions, and how do we face them? We also need to understand that the broader framework is necessary for people like us, all of us, to understand. And to build a just and equal society, you have to take positions sometimes which are unpopular, unpleasant, but just. How capable are we to do that? As we stand here today, I conclude, but the story goes on. And I don't think it's going to end with this. It'll go on, and it'll go on with populist success. It'll go with a desire for implementing fundamental guarantees under the Constitution. It must also be contained by a strong political voice outside, which is India has had since Mahatma Gandhi, called people's movements. Because if these people's movements do not stand solidly and raise these issues which are unpleasant, which are critical, critique the system, raise issues of justice and equality, any system that we put in place will dither. And I think that position must be seen by everybody today as a good position. We tend to have a kind of what we call in Hindi, bhed chal. We follow like sheep. So when something succeeds, everyone wants to leap into that. But we must understand that there is need for a dialectic. If there is a Mallika Sarabhai wanting to join politics, there must be somebody else outside to take up the voice that Mallika probably can't raise inside. There are some things you cannot raise inside. So there has to be a dialectic and an understanding between Mallika and others, or between anyone who goes in and outside, to keep that balance straight. And as good friends have always told me in the political and bureaucratic system, that a dharna is very good, because what they cannot say within the system, the dharna will say with impunity, because it couldn't care less. It neither wants votes nor promotion or a good confidential report. So the dharna will say anything it wants to say. So it's a very powerful and important voice. And I think that voice must remain. We must also think of a new collective leadership. This pitting one person against the other is very American to me. It's not India. We need a collective. We need people who will form leadership, be accountable to their peers and also to me. You can't be just one person. How can you deal? And I'm standing in Andhra with the Telangana and Andhra crisis subsuming you. So how can you have one person decide anything? How can you have one person be the symbol of governance? I think it's from the beginning mythical. And here, I'll quote Eduardo Galeano, now one of my recent favorites, a great political thinker from South America and a writer. And he says that we create these huge cardboard figures. And what brings to my mind is South India, especially Tamil Nadu, my state, where you have these huge cutouts. I don't think they're there now to quite the same degree, maybe because of RTI. But there you have these cutouts, and these cutouts, as soon as one goes, the cutout just crumbles and another cutout is put into place. He says we create these two-dimensional figures, and once rot sets in, we damn democracy, we damn leadership, we damn everything else. But there's something wrong with us that we do not see that democracy is about collective leadership. You have a cabinet, which must be equally good. You must have a team of people who are sufficiently intelligent to look at the issues. You can't have a one-person leadership. Therefore, I'll quote my friend Lal Singh. And I'll speak in Hindi because he spoke in Hindi. Lal Singh, MKSS has no leader. We are a group of 30 people, and we're all leaders. And we're all equal. There's no president, there's no vice president, there's no treasurer, there is no secretary, there's no general secretary. We're all equal. And Lal Singh Ji is, to me, symbolizes the wisdom and the thought of the MKSS. We went to an institute in Jaipur, which trains IAS and regional service officers. And since it's Mazdoor Kisan Shakti Sangathana, and I'm neither nor a mazdoor nor a kisan. And Nikhil came with me, he's neither a mazdoor nor kisan. Shankar is, at least he knows, he has worked. We took Narayan and Lal Singh Ji with us, so they thought that they brought some tokens. So they gave me, Nikhil and Shankar, 5 or 10 minutes each to speak. When it came to Lal Singh Ji's turn, they looked at their watch and said, time for lunch. Say what you have to say in 3 minutes. And what Lal Singh Ji said about information to me applies equally about democracy. But I'll say what he said, then just take a minute to expand, and then I'll end. He said in Hindi, hum sochte hain ki suchna ka adhikar nahi milega, to kya hum jiyenge ya nahi jiyenge? Aap sochte hain ki suchna ka adhikar mil jaye, to kya aapki kursi rahegi ya nahi rahegi? Magar doston, hum sabko milkar sochna chahiye ki kya ye desh rahega ya nahi rahega. So this is the quality of thinking and real leadership that has pushed right to information ahead. And I have faith and hope that there are hundreds of thousands of Lal Singhs in this country. There are hundreds and thousands of Sushilas in this country. And they are the real Thank leaders you. Of a new India. Thank you.
On behalf of all of us, I'd like to thank you. This has been a tremendous experience, a wonderful lecture. Thank you for sharing so much of your experience and yourself with us. From the University of Hyderabad, thank you. Kind enough to answer a few questions from the audience. We have a short question and answer session. Ramesh?
Right to information is a precursor or a precondition to democratic governance, if that is the case. Can you throw some light on the other conditions that really get the democratic governance happen in this country? Like human security is a big deal, where we have right to health, right to education, right to water, because poor people are not able to buy water also to drink. So this is the condition where we are living in. So can you elaborate on the human security aspects? Thank you.
My question is more empirical rather than theoretical, because I did some study on MKSS, that is establishing transparent, accountable and responsive governance through the participation of non-party political organizations in electoral politics. And the second thing is that I also participated in Samajik Education Ke Bare Mein Paidarya. It was initiated by MKSS in Rajasthan and in Philippines. From these experiences, it is clear that the source as well as energy for the both transparency and accountability are basically from the poorest of the poor, rural, illiterate, women, kisan and mazdoor. Because of these efforts of these people, today we can see the Right Information Act as well as the social audit. Of course, social audit is an inbuilt institutionalized mechanism in the MGNRHS. And retrospectively, when you look at the 8 years experience of these two institutions, these two mechanisms, what it reveals, the statistical data indicates that where hardly the 15% of the rural poorest of the poor people are the beneficiaries. The maximum beneficiaries of the Right Information Act are the erstwhile custodians of the confidentiality in the government, that is the government officials, regarding their reports such as appointment, promotions, demotions, transfers, etc. These are the maximum beneficiaries of the Right Information Act. Second is that the social audit. Social audit, which is supposed to be conducted by the community, but today it has become an official audit. And these social audit institutions are being headed by a recruited bureaucrat or an NGO bureaucrat. And this has been directed in the very purpose of the social audit. Therefore, now my question is that how you are going to resolve this issue of the getting the maximum benefits to the rural poor and minimum benefits to these already privileged sections of the society?
Ma'am, I am a PhD scholar in public administration. Ma'am, as it is known that guarantee to governance, it is seen as a change in the pattern and behavior of the bureaucracy. And as you have said that bureaucracy technically work in deliberative work that to delay the promotion of the welfare scheme performance. It has been said that government agencies, particularly the bureaucrats, deny the rights of the people because of the prestige and power they enjoy. And RTI does empower people, but where is the area in which the patterns of behavior can be changed of the bureaucrat themselves? Or bureaucracy is inevitable evil for the government.
I'll take the first question first about RTI and other rights. Actually, the right to information is, I think, basic in a very, very fundamental sense. If you look at the way RTI is used, RTI by itself is nothing but RTI. You have to ask a right to information question about something, whether it's water, or whether it's family welfare, or whether it's education, or marks in an, or whether it's corruption in a big scan or a PDS, it has got to be about something. So the right to information really gives you access to facts. So in a sense, it facilitates. That's why Mr. S.R. Shankaran called it a transformatory act. It is an act which helps you transform all your the information you get from any area into a right. And therefore, you fight with facts. Usually, we are told that this is not what is there. You're manufacturing. But actually, manufacturing information takes place everywhere, within the system and outside. But when you get that information rubber stamped and told that it's verified copy of X file, it becomes the basis of your real battle. So in that sense, it's empowered everybody. You have engineers without borders, doctors without borders. You have local people asking their PHCs, local women asking their midwives and their ALMs for their, you know, their, all their subsidies. I mean, in any case, it goes across the border. But eventually, for a poor person, you need to strengthen every single one of them. And to strengthen them, you need a spate of other rights. You need a spate of other laws. That's why after the right to information and the MGNREGA, you've had so many other laws which are now seen as enabling people to get what is basically sense of justice, sense of equality, and sense of protection of their human rights and rights. So it is enabled, and it's also made people think about governance. Before this, governance was a non-issue. Now governance is an issue. So it's an overall kind of awareness and understanding, and also a specific tool that it's given you in your hand. In case of RTI and MGNREGA, I think MGNREGA is unpopular with the media because it is for the poor. So you're right in saying that some percentage of the poor have got it. In fact, if we go back to Rajiv Gandhi's famous statement, 1 rupee to the village and only 15 paise reaches, which has gone down the rounds. And you see what's happening today with MGNREGA. 1 rupee goes and roughly between 40 to 60 paise is realized. And 40 paise goes under in corruption in some places and 60 goes in corruption in some other places. But if you take an average, at least half is reaching. I'm taking a very conservative point of view. So 50% is reaching. So we've gone up from 15 to 50. It's a huge jump. But we, of course, must speak of the other 50. When you had food for work, nobody knew what money was coming into the village. So the entire thing could have been a write-off as it was. When we did one of our public hearings in a place called Janavar, we found one anecdote booked 3 times. Because nobody knew there were 3 anecdotes sanctioned. There was only one anecdote was sanctioned. We found that the veterinary hospital was never built. Because nobody knew that the veterinary hospital had been sanctioned. So as soon as information came out, they madly built the veterinary hospital on top of the panchayat. And you should have heard the laughter and the derision. They said, oh, now animals are going to climb up to have themselves treated. So all these anomalies happen only because you know. So NREGA is forced to tell people what it brings with it. So it has succeeded to some extent in that. And at least in Rajasthan, we have, I don't know how many lakhs of walls painted with all the information. You find yellow walls wherever you go in Rajasthan, information is painted outside. So the MIS is for people like you and me. We call that the Janta Information System. It's outside. So every child can see the name and say, oh, that's my neighbor. He's been in Bombay on migration. How is his name there? And where are those 2,500 rupees? Materials, I didn't see so many bags of cement come. I want to know, I want to see the records. So in a sense, NGNRED has benefited extensively from RTI. And therefore, I would say that this division between RTI and NGNRED is wrong. Because if there had been no use of RTI and NGNREDA, the poor wouldn't have got these benefits. So I think, in a sense, RTI has reached the very poor substantively and legitimately. Now, if we just take RTI as an RTI application alone, then maybe you will find, according to the reports, only the urban areas using them, and people who can read and write use them. But I'm telling you that there is no record maintained at the panchayat level of how many applications come. There's no record maintained at the panchayat samiti level or the block level of how many applications come. Even if districts don't have information, you only go by the information of your commission. And the commission obviously gets the second appeal, and therefore there are cases which will deal with issues which are far more complicated, or issues where there is resistance from the bureaucracy. So in a sense, the information that we collect at present is very selective. And this is another big debate. How do you present data, how do you present facts, determines how you argue or what you think you know. And therefore, the collection of data itself is a huge issue for us. You know the famous Planning Commission figures. There are three and poverty line data. Depends on where you stand, you'll use any argument you want. Then of course, Planning Commission said we can live on 23 rupees a day. Then they said we can live on 32 rupees a day. We went with boxes to the Planning Commission. In the box I had meant for Monday, my box, it had only two bus tickets coming to the Planning Commission and going back. And the 32 rupees is finished. So in a sense, all this data is also very baffling. So I think there should be, maybe the university can even apply its mind to see how authentic data can actually be collected. And so far as the bureaucratic delay is concerned, and the bureaucracy itself, the right to information is mourned by people. They don't like it in the service. And I know that one of my colleagues and friends, Harsh Pandar, went to the academy to lecture to IAS officers recently, and he said to me, you know, Aruna, we're very unpopular. I said, now what's happened? He said, they said, you two guys who left us and went out, creating the biggest headache for us with the RTI. So in a sense, it's dislike, because transparency means accountability straight away. So they dislike it. But we have to have other acts. We have to have the things like the service delivery bill. We have to have grievance redress bills passed so that the grievances are redressed. Rajasthan has passed a right to hearing act, where you have a right to be heard. And taking the RTI architecture into the law, if you don't give a speaking order in 21 days, you're fined. The officer is fined, the official is fined. So you'll have to think of ways in which pressure can be put on the system to function. And you're right, because you have to have a civil service. That's why it's so important that their actions are transparent and monitored. I don't think there's any other way out, because systems are there, systems have to be used, and systems have to function. But one thing, this is a footnote, you didn't ask me the question, but when I was in the IAS and subsequently till about 15-20 years ago, IAS officers used to go and live in villages and see how the poor lived. Today they are sent to Malaysia, to Korea, to the West, to see how corporates can function. So when they come back, they'll do just that. They'll help business. So it depends on what your policy of training is, and none of us have raised any issues, including me, about how an IAS officer should be trained to address the real constitutional issues which remain undone in this country. How will they deal with discrimination? How will they deal with all the difficult issues? And I know it's very difficult. As a junior IAS officer, I never knew whom to believe. Because there'd be 5-6 people telling me different things. It's very difficult sometimes to decide where the truth lies. But the point is, that's where I think the real training should be. Because ultimately, how to please corporations and companies, we'll all learn anyway. But we'll have to learn how to deal with our own country, people who are less privileged than we are. Maybe that's another issue to fight for now.